So now I'm going to speak. I'm going to present for 25 minutes or so on a subject to do with Shakespearean biography. And this comes from, as we know, 2016 was the all the celebrations in April around the 400th, which I guess standing here last year, we would have thought was going to be the big event in 2016. looking back from now, it seems almost to have passed without a whimper. But despite that fact, many people were involved in the celebrations or whatever in April, and there was a lot of academic work produced to coincide with that. And I co-edited a journal with Professor Paolo Pugliatti from the University of Florence called The Many Lives of William Shakespeare, which came out around about April time, in which I did write about Shakespearean biography, and that's leading up to that, and also working with Kevin. Kevin did his PhD with me at Brunel. It really gave me a great interest in the Shakespearean biography. So preparing for that paper led me to certain thoughts, and then thinking about that, going on from that for today's, has made me think further around Shakespearean biography. And so I wanted to call this, when I started, I wanted to call this presentation, this is a quote from Flaubert, from Madame Bovary, "Knocking out tunes for bears to dance to," okay, which is somehow how I view Shakespearean biography, which I call Shakespearean biography, and I'll explain why I call it Bardography. Okay, so I wanted to call it that, but then 2016 happened, and so I thought... I wanted to link it to other things that it seemed to me... seemed to me to be entirely appropriate, given the various things that have happened this year. So... bear with me, this is a paper that is a work in progress, if you like. The ideas aren't finalised, but so here goes. So I want to start with quite an extended... Actually, I want to stay on that picture now that I think about it. I want to start with an extended quote from Madame Bovary, and the first quote is... It's quite late on in the novel. It's when Emma is talking to her lover. You know, she's his mistress, and of course, unknown to her husband, this is going on. She has very strong feelings for her lover. He's a bit of a cad, Rudolph, and doesn't reciprocate. But this is what she says to him in this scene. She says, "Oh, it's because I love you," she went on. "Love you so much, I can't live without you. Did you realise? Sometimes I'm longing to see you again and the furies of love pull me apart. I say to myself, where is he? Talking to other women, perhaps? They're smiling at him. He comes closer. No, it's not like that, is it? I'm your slave and your concubine. You're my king, my idol. You are good, beautiful, intelligent, strong." I realise I shouldn't have put that in a slide just following Trump, but never mind. So this is Emma speaking to her lover. This is his response. It's a very famous passage from Flaubert. He had heard such stuff so many times that the words meant very little to him. Emma was just like any other mistress, and the charm of novelty falling down slowly like a dress exposed only the eternal monotony of passion, always the same forms and the same language. He did not distinguish, this man of such great expertise, the differences of sentiment beneath the sameness of their expressions. Because he had heard such like phrases murmured to him from the lips of the licentious or the venal, he hardly believed in hers. You must, he thought, beware of turgid speeches, masking commonplace passions, as though the soul's abundance does not sometimes spill over in the most decrepit metaphors, since no one can ever give the exact measure of their needs, their ideas, their afflictions. And since human speech is like a cracked cauldron, a on which we knock out tunes for bears to dance to when we wish to conjure pity from the stars. So as I say, this is one of Flaubert's most famous passages, and it captures not only the sentiments of his central characters and indeed the point of view of his narrator, but also says something quite profound about the limiting nature of language itself, its tendency towards the mundane and the commonplace, and the difficulty, perhaps impossibility, of deep communication. It points to the shallow nature of such exchange, of the emptiness of the orthodox and the oft-repeated. When we communicate, we want, or we should want, to conjure pity from the stars. Instead, we merely knock out tunes for bears to dance to and say nothing new, nothing deep, nothing worthwhile. Now, for me, this nicely captures the parameters of the genre or the subgenre of Shakespearean biography, a subgenre I've named elsewhere with due deference to the term bardolatry. I've named it bardography, and which should, I believe, it should aspire to something profound and beautiful, but which instead has become a register of uncritical reiterations of discredited mythologies. So in this paper, I want to discuss the limits of bardography and attempt to provide reasons why this practice is both misguided and at the same time popular. Indeed, it is received knowledge, or it has been traditionally. So I want to contemplate why so many dance to the sounds which emanate from this cracked cauldron of orthodoxy. Now, in the last few years, I've become fascinated by Shakespearean biography, as I explained, and I've become particularly obsessed in what many would no doubt regard, my wife included, in an unhealthy and troubling fashion. I've become obsessed with a specific manifestation of this subgenre in the following passage, and I've read this here before, in an article entitled, "What Was He Really Like?" by Sir Stanley Wells. As a boy, this is, obviously he's talking about Shakespeare. As a boy, he howled and wept, smiled and laughed. He played games with his siblings and was irritated when they could not keep time in their recorder playing. He walked to and from school with his satchel on his back. He learned to read and write, to swim and ride a horse, and he struggled with Latin grammar. He went regularly to church and thought, as any intelligent boy would, about what he heard there. He ate and drank, belched and farted, urinated and defecated. You can substitute the Anglo-Saxon terms if you wish. Thanks, Stanley. As adolescence came on, he began to experience erections and to feel desire. He masturbated, and earlier than most of his contemporaries, copulated. So my wife is really troubled by it. I keep reading this in bed every night. But in many ways, I've written about this article myself, and in an article which I termed Shakespeare in Biography, Too Much Information. In brackets, but not about Shakespeare. So there really is, in the modern kind of street parlance, too much information here, as in, stop, please, Stanley, stop. Stop, please, no more. But what there is not is any information about Shakespeare. Everything that Wells writes here and continues to write in his article is fiction. Now, I want to ponder that for a moment, okay, and drag you into my world, the significance of what we're saying here. So in an academic article entitled, "What Was He Really Like?", we are provided with an entirely fictional account of Shakespeare growing up by the foremost orthodox Shakespearean scholar in the United Kingdom. So now, as Kevin will tell us later on, accepted practice in biography as a genre naturally allows for the biographer to interpret the actions of his or her subject in relation to known events. In this case, accepted practice is ignored. It is pure fiction, and there are no events to interpret here. This is biography in a vacuum. This is bardography. Now, what Wells has produced here and his motivation for its production is, I would suggest, a microcosm of the entire subgenre of Shakespearean biography. And I'm sure you must know them. There are so many. They come out regularly. Every year you'll see a new Shakespearean biography. And what I'm suggesting is they all, in some way, adhere to the sorts of practices that Wells is using here. Now, the vast majority of biographers of Shakespeare admit that there is nothing, or at least, or almost nothing, in the records, in biographical terms, to explain Shakespeare's life as a writer, and then proceed normally over hundreds and hundreds of pages to produce a comprehensive biography of Shakespeare that delineates his writing life in detail. Now, the problems inherent in attempting to write a biography of Shakespeare have been well rehearsed over the years, not least in Kevin's work, which is really great. And I don't wish to repeat them at length here. Some of these problems, such as the fact that we have no records for Shakespeare at all between his baptism and his marriage some 18 years later, should certainly, I would suggest, give Stanley Wells pause for thought when considering this. The more profound problem arises, however, when we consider that none of the records which do exist help us to understand Shakespeare's life as a writer. There are no records of his receiving payment for writing, no manuscripts, no diaries, no letters. Simply no writer's profile exists for him. As Diana Price has shown brilliantly, when we examine the works of, when we examine the records of Shakespeare's life, we generally find him deeply involved in business dealings, and not in literary pursuits. Now, this has led me elsewhere to state that there are, in fact, in my view, two Shakespeares. There is Will of the Records and Will of the Works. Okay, Will of the Records and Will of the Works. Now, furthermore, what I've said is the fact that the former, Will of the Works, lacks any significance when related to the latter makes it clear that the received wisdom concerning the relationship between the two wills is deeply flawed. For it's a relationship that is impossible to construct rationally. It can only really be constructed, as Wells shows, fictionally. Of the two wills, the one is a man who existed, but in terms of a writing life, is nothing. And the other, the one who is everything in the works, does not exist and never existed. Now, given this, it would seem that, as Brian Cumming says, and this is where my thoughts are going now, it seems that the first folio itself is what best represents the life. That is, it's the place in which the man does not exist that explains the man. Now, for me, this is the critical intersection when it comes to Shakespearean biography. For it's here, in this moment, at this interface, if you like, of everything and nothing, that the subgenre of Shakespearean biography is brought into being. It's here, as the richness of the works meets the poverty of the recorded life, where the complexity of the plays and poems meets the empty vessel that is the life of the author, that this subgenre is born. And it's here as well where this empty vessel becomes filled with details, filled with anecdotes, excuse me, filled with life events that did not, as far as we know, happen. It's here, for example, that Stephen Greenblatt, Richard Wilson, and Michael Wood fill this empty vessel with Catholicism. It's here that Catherine Duncan Jones fills it with ungentle and unrecorded, quote, scenes from his life. It's here that Carol Chillington Rutter fills it with, quote, the mental imprint of the grammar school. It's here that René Weiss fills it with a profound relationship with the Earl of Southampton, and here that Stanley Wells has this empty vessel masturbating and copulating. Sorry, wife. But why is this? Why do biographers admit to the emptiness of this vessel? and then proceed to fill it with supposition, anecdote, academic guesswork, and aspects of their own obsessions. In the remainder of this talk, I want to attempt to answer this question and to demonstrate, I hope, the relation between this phenomenon and the seismic phenomena of Brexit and President-elect Trump. So let me begin with... I didn't make this up, OK? It's on the internet, and as my 14-year-old son says, it's on the internet, it must be true, OK? So, let me begin with a question, OK? What is the aim of Shakespearean biography? What is its end goal, OK? Now, essentially, the answer to this question is this. The end goal of Shakespearean biography is to explain the works to us and to explain our relationship to the works. We are almost overwhelmed by the works and we want to explain them, their depth, their broadness, their intellectual span. I knew I shouldn't have put that up. Everyone's reading that now. Is it people? Okay, so stop looking at that, look at me, okay? This is what I have to do at university. Anyway, so we want the depth of the works, their broadness and their intellectual span explained to us, and our relationship to those works explained to us. Now, Shakespearean biography does this for us. Experts using their deep familiarity with the texts and with the historical period to provide us with an understanding of this sublime literary output. Or at least that's what they should be doing. And that's what they, although they claim that's what they're doing, it's not quite what they're doing, because orthodoxy feels that this explication and explanation can only be achieved by assigning the works an author, the man from Stratford. They attempt to explain the works through the man, as it were. As such, Shakespearean biography is about bringing order to the plenitude of the literary work, or at least about assigning truth and thereby constraining the potential proliferation of meanings. I'll explain this a bit more as I go on. Essentially, what orthodoxy is doing is they place all of the works in this category called Shakespeare, and all interpretation has to take place within the parameters of that category. Now, let me give you an example. It's one I've used before. It's one I use at university. Some years ago in The Guardian, Professor John Sutherland wrote an article, and it was a very good title to the article. The article was called, "Is This a Pint I See Before Me?" So I thought, that's very good. It went a bit downhill from there, I have to say. And what the question that Professor John Sutherland had set himself was this. Okay, we all agree, Shakespeare's works, fantastic, some of the best writing, perhaps the best writing ever, sublime, blah, blah, blah. However, there are bad bits. Okay, there are bits in Shakespeare that are rubbish. How do we explain that? So he went about, you know, thinking about this, and the conclusion he reached was that Shakespeare lived just around here. Okay, it was a very lively literary environment. He was out quite a lot in the evening in the tavern, knocking back the ale, and very often he'd wake up in the morning with a hangover. That's when he wrote his bad stuff. Okay? The good stuff he wrote probably in the afternoon when he had had a bacon sandwich or something and he was coming around. The mornings, with a hangover, that's when he wrote some of the really bad stuff that appears in the plays. Now, it's a theory, it's a thesis, okay? The important bit of it for me is what he's setting himself is, right, Shakespeare, this one person wrote all of these works. Some of it's good, some of it's bad. How do I explain that? And he has to, within those constraints, explain the bad bits. And this is the theory he comes up with. Now, what he could do, and indeed what we do, is approach that in a different way and say, right, there are good bits and bad bits. The writing is variable over these enormous number of works. How can we explain that? Perhaps more than one person was involved. Okay. Now, that would lead you to different conclusions, and it may lead you to a more authentic conclusion than his conclusion, which I think most people would regard as kind of absurd. And really, he is, in many ways, setting himself an impossible task by being stuck, by constraining himself in his view of what the writer was like. Now, this practice of categorization is what I'm suggesting is having this category called Shakespeare, okay, it's about a desire for wholeness and for bringing order and comfort through understanding. Andrew Bennett says, if an author doesn't exist, we have to invent him or her. We make them in an image of our desire for transcendent, originary unity. Now, Shakespeare's biography does not in any way explain the life. It cannot. It's rather an attempt to explain the chaos or the plenitude of the works, their amazing depth, their breadth, and their diversity. The end product is, as we have seen, a subgenre which does not attend to its own constraints. It's not essentially biography at all, but something rather more akin to what an American scholar called Marjorie Garber has very thought-provokingly called it a dream space of nostalgia. Now, it's here, in many ways, the moment where we begin to understand what orthodox Shakespearean biography really is. It's where the plenitude of the works meets the emptiness of the life, and they're forced together to bring an end to the proliferation of potential meanings and thus potential authors. This leads me to say, in fact, Shakespeare does not exist other than as a means to bring order to the chaos that orthodoxy envisages in a world without Shakespeare. It's an invented category to bring order to that world. He does not exist other than a means to constrain meaning, to explain the world, and thus bring comfort. Okay, and this is what I'm suggesting is it's a mythological explanation. So those of you who are religious or Christian religious, you may believe in the story of Genesis about the creation of the world. We live now in a post-scientific society where there's a scientific explanation for that, the Big Bang, so on and so forth. Probably most people in the Western world believe in that scientific explanation, and only religious people believe in that mythological explanation. It is an explanation. It works, but it is a mythological explanation. That's what I'm saying Shakespearean orthodoxy is. So this... it's not biography. Shakespearean biography is not biography, and nor is it knowledge. It's mythology, is what I'm saying. Which leads me directly to Donald Trump. Now, according to the French theorist Jean Baudrillard, technology has overcome humanity. Okay? For him, for Baudrillard, the apocalypse has already happened, and we live in a post-apocalyptic society. The apocalypse is the technological revolution of the last 20 years, which is changing every aspect of our life, not just physically, in the physical environment, but psychologically. Okay, it's changing us psychologically. And now for him, this revolution is not necessarily a bad thing. As many of the concepts that traditionally we've used to structure our lives, structure human society, around things like gender, sexuality, identity itself. Many of these categories by which humanity has defined itself for hundreds of years are coming to an end. Okay? And one of those categories may well be rational political discourse. Now, such a concept is orthodoxy, Shakespearean orthodoxy. It's a concept or a category which has regulated, mapped, policed, and controlled our interaction with the author of the first folio. Orthodox Shakespeare is a concept which has, been used to constrain meaning. And as we know to our cost, many of us in this room, Orthodox Shakespeare scholars have indeed mapped the possible realms of truth in this subject area. They have mapped what it is possible to say, and they have regulated, policed, and controlled these realms of truth, and wherever possible, have stated that what we, non-Stratfordians, are, what we say, we are outside of those realms of truth, constructed and policed by them, and that we therefore speak untruths. Back to Baudrillard for a moment. Now, this enormous increase in information dissemination and in new technologies has led to a newly complicated reality for all of us. By this I mean, the world has always been complex. It's because it's so multifaceted, it's made up of so many elements, of course. But our interaction with the world as a single human being used to be, in comparison with now, relatively simple. Being aware and, to some extent, in control of what was local to us. Now, this began to change with television, of course, as we became more aware of the world around us. However, in the last 20 years, technology has enabled a minute-by-minute explosion of information that is at all times accessible to us, and we struggle with this new complexity. We're bombarded with information from across the globe and have not developed the means yet to filter it, to process it, to understand it. Now, a good example, I don't know if anyone's on Twitter. If you just scroll through Twitter, you know, and depending on how many followers you have, if you've only got four, then, okay, you won't get this, but you scroll through Twitter and you see, right, okay, 20 puppies found dead in a wheelbarrow in Cleethorpes. Somebody in a Japanese psychiatric unit has murdered 40 people. A bomb's gone off in Aleppo. There's someone's been raped, you know, locally. There's all of this information that's bombarding you the whole time, okay? And it has an impact. It's very difficult to filter that. And we see it in many of our young people. Many of our young people do lack a kind of resilience, you know, an ability, really, to cope with the world. And I see this particularly in university and at schools, where we have many, many more students now who have some form of mental illness or whatever. And it's their lack of resilience is part of that, their inability, really, to process the world as they now experience it, through social media particularly. But it's not only kids. My parents are the same. My parents, quite old people, you know, they got an iPad, so my mum tries to use the iPad, does it quite well, but you can just feel them getting more and more wound up and more frightened by all of this information that they're receiving the whole time. Now, what I'm saying is that this interaction with the world now through social media and the media, it often takes the form for people of an inability to understand the world anymore and cries of, what's going on? Okay, what's happening to the world? Now, we experience a kind of vertigo in the modern world, and we're caught between dying and emerging paradigms and the apparent complexity of the 24/7 digitized and mediated world overwhelms us. We could talk about the migrant crisis, for example. Okay? It seems so complex, and so the solution seems so contingent, we feel paralyzed and unable to act in this current migrant crisis. But migrant crises have always been complex. We were just not aware of the complexity, and we're not bombarded with the differing discourses around it as we are now. And so finally, simplistic solutions begin to make sense. They offer both a reduction in the complexity and a solution to what overwhelms us. And these simple solutions become attractive, and they comfort us, they calm us. Make America great again. Take back control. These statements do not really bear analysis as solutions, but they do offer comfort, stability, control. And this is precisely, I'm suggesting, what the Orthodox narrative of the Shakespeare story offers. It does not bear analysis, but it offers simplicity, stability, and comfort. And it ends the potential proliferation of meanings. It ends complexity. Orthodox Shakespearean scholarship, at least with regard to biography, is not scholarship at all. It's the simulation of scholarship, the aim of which is not truth, the aim is comfort and stability. As such, Shakespeare, or at least the orthodox version of him, in my view, beckons Trump and beckons Brexit as we no longer feel overwhelmed by uncertainty and instability, if you're of a certain frame of mind, of course. Now, I'm coming to the end. I realise that what I've said here about Shakespeare applies to any theory of single authorship of the works, of the first folio. I say this not to antagonise, but just to clarify. Any theory of single authorship naturally brings it with it stability. This case in point, Shakespeare's works, is different precisely because it is in dispute and because multiple authorship is a viable possibility. So to end, here's my story of Shakespeare. Okay, now I've put this up. This is a plug for a book that's coming out next year. A number of authors are in the room today that are contributing to it, and I'm editing that. So, here's my story of Shakespeare. I've always felt that the story is complex. Recent computer analysis, I don't know if anyone knows about all the stylometric analyses and so on and so forth. Now, recent computer analysis of the works, which is part of the technological revolution that's overwhelming us, they seem to suggest that complexity is certainly the defining characteristic of the authorship of the first folio. Now, the various authors of the computer analysis, they can't agree, thus far, who actually wrote the plays, only that the first folio is the work of numerous authors. Now, it's not what we want to hear, perhaps, as we're so tied to the romantic notion of the single author genius, but it is perhaps the complicated truth. And so, to another grand statement, sorry. Now, this is said in the spirit of inquiry rather than certainty. In my view, we have to learn, both in terms of the Shakespeare story and in terms of our lives generally now, to live with complexity, with uncertainty, and with an amount of vertigo. That's the new reality. It's not easy, as the situation is not stable and is changing almost daily, but we must try, as only then can we get closer to the truth and can the real story of the authorship of the plays been told. Only then can we attempt to conjure pity from the stars. Thank you.